Hi everyone and welcome to the AnimaMaestro Conductor video series, which will present the electronic circuit at the heart of my animatronic project. We're going to talk about microcontrollers, CPLDs, SD cards, audio DACs, LCD displays, matrix keyboards and much more. Welcome to AnimaMaestro. Hi everyone and welcome again to the channel. If you're new here, please take the time to subscribe and turn on the notification bell. That would really help the channel. So in the first video of this brand new series, I'm going to present and talk about AnimaMaestro Conductor, which is the electronic circuit at the heart of my project. But first things first, please take a look at this. Isn't this beautiful? I mean, for as long as I can remember, I always loved looking at electronic circuits. When I was young, I would open every electronic toy that I own and I would basically look at the electronic circuits. I would even do that with my computer and musical keyboard and even my television. And all of this, even though my parents kept telling me not to do it, I would still do it because I love looking at electronic circuits. And I remember when I was looking at the circuits, I was telling myself, one day I'm gonna know how this works and I'm gonna be able to make my own. So that's why I went and studied electrical engineering when I went to the university. But over the course of my studies, I turned more towards software engineering. So when I started working on this animatronic project many years ago, it was really obvious to me that I would include a lot of electronic boards to fulfill my passion for electronic circuits, because even though I had learned the basics at university, I still lacked the experience, so that was my chance. This version of the board is an older one, but let's take a look at all the major components. Let's see how it will evolve to the next version, and let's figure out what the AnimaMaestro Conductor can do. At the heart of the circuit is the microcontroller. So this is the processor that orchestrates all the components of the board. So I guess you could say that this is the actual conductor of my project. For all my electronic projects, I use microchip PIC32 microcontrollers. So there are a lot of devices to choose from and you know, there's one for every needs. And the development environment is really enjoyable too. I quite love working with it. So microcontrollers are much like regular computer microprocessors, but one of the main differences is that they include most of the peripherals inside the chip. Nowadays, you will find microcontrollers with embedded USB modules, Ethernet modules, analog to digital converters and their counterparts, all sorts of serial and parallel communication devices, and of course, a lot of general purpose input and output pins, otherwise called GPIO pins. Now, for this particular board, the microcontroller that I chose is not completely suited for my project. On one hand, I do not use it to its fullest potential. There are some devices in it that I could have used, but I didn't. And on the other hand, it lacks also some of the peripherals that I might have benefited from. So for the next revisions of the board, I will choose a processor that is better suited for my particular application. So once you have your microcontroller, you know, one of the first things that you can do with it is use it to control LEDs. And this project is no exception. So if you take a look here at the casing of my AnimaMaestro Conductor project, you can see a bunch of LEDs. The simplest way to light an LED is, of course, to use a GPIO pin that you set to 1 to light the LED and to 0 to turn it off. But you can also use a technique that is called a pulse width modulation, or PWM, to control the intensity of the LED. So that's what I use for this project, and we'll talk about it more in future videos. The next really useful thing that you would usually add to a circuit like this one is the ability to input some information to the microcontroller using buttons and switches and keyboards. So the simplest way to do this is to use one GPIO input pin for every button and every keys of your keyboard. But you will find out that it quickly adds up and basically uses all your GPIO pins. So another technique is to organize your keys and buttons into a matrix. This way it greatly reduces the number of required pins. And with this technique, what you do is you periodically scan each row of the keyboard by sending a logic 1 to one row at a time, and then reading all the columns to see if one of them is active, and if so, it will read back a 1. So that way you know that the key at the intersection of that row and that column is the key being pressed. For this project, I have found this really nice 4x4 membrane keypad, which I like a lot because it allows you to design your own key layout, print it on a sheet of paper, and then you can slide the sheet inside the keypad, and there you have your own customized keypad. And this is what I did for this project. If your project requires to display more meaningful information and LEDs are not enough, you can use an LCD display module like this one. So LCD display modules, they can be either alphanumeric, so they can display letters and numbers and symbols, or they can be graphic, and you can control basically each individual pixel to display images of your liking. So in this project, I chose an alphanumeric display module. And what is really nice about choosing such a module is that it really simplifies the design, because all the logic that is required to drive the display and all the communication protocols are included inside the module. So it makes the communication with them and the inclusion in your design really more simple. LCD display modules are really popular and readily available almost everywhere, and also the information and the libraries to design and code for LCD display modules are really available everywhere. So you will see that if you want to include such a display in your project, you can do it very easily and quickly. Sometimes in projects like this one, you realize that you need to realize extra logic functions outside of the microcontrollers. And to do such functions, you can of course rely on discrete logic components, such as AND gates, OR gates, inverter gates, or registers. But when the number of discrete components increases and gets too large, you can turn to what we call complex programmable logic devices, or CPLDs. So they are basically programmable devices that can perform a lot of basic logic functions to complement the microcontroller. For all my electronic projects, I use Xilinx XC95 CPLDs. So they are devices that contain a lot of registers, a lot of AND gates and OR gates, and of course, a lot of input-output pins. So you program them using a language that is called Verilog. So in future videos in this series, we'll take a closer look at how we program CPLDs. My AnimaMaestro Conductor project currently includes 4 different CPLDs, and I would like to talk to you about 2 of them right now. So this one here is called the Power Controller. So basically what I wanted to do with this project was to be able to turn on the device simply by pressing a key on the keyboard. So in order to do so, I needed a small device to always stay powered, and that device would scan the power on key of my keyboard and turn on the rest of the device when needed. And this device was also managing the reset function, so either the automatic reset on power on or the reset button. So this is why I designed the power controller using a small CPLD. It was perfect for this task. The second CPLD on this board is called the peripheral controller. So that's because I have a lot of devices on this board, and often I needed to add some extra support circuitry to perform simple tasks. So I basically packed all of this extra logic inside this CPLD. The next thing that I needed the AnimaMaestro Conductor to achieve was for it to be able to communicate with a host computer through USB. So I needed a software to be able to communicate with the AnimaMaestro Conductor to configure and control it. So if you want to learn more about my control and animation software, you can take a look at my AnimaMaestro Composer video series. In order to support USB communication, I could have relied on the USB module that is actually present inside the microcontroller that I chose for this project. But because I designed this project based on a previous one, I decided to keep using the device that I was using then. That previous project included a USB FIFO device made by FTDI, so that's what I kept using in this project instead of relying on the actual USB module inside a microcontroller. The USB FIFO, it has some advantages. The first one is that it's really easy to interface with it, both from the hardware and software perspectives. And also no knowledge of USB specifications is needed, so it's all done for you. So, but for the next version of my board, I definitely intend to use the actual USB module inside the microcontroller. Another thing that I really wanted for my AnimaMaestro Conductor was for it to be able to control my animatronic autonomously. So I wanted it to be able to play back audio and animation data without the use of the host application. This is why I included an SD card reader and writer on this board. There are two protocols to interface with an SD card, the simplest of the two being through a serial peripheral interface, or SPI. And by the way, in French, we say SPI, so you might hear me say that from time to time. Like for most of the devices included in this project, if you choose to include an SD card reader and writer to your project, you will definitely find a lot of resources online, design guides, code libraries. But of course, you know me, like for the rest of this project, I decided that I will not use these resources and write my own driver. So I implemented a simple FAT16 file system, and that is the basis of my SD card driver. The next really important thing that I wanted my AnimaMaestro Conductor to do was to be able to actually play the audio soundtrack of my animatronic. So that's why I included a stereo digital to analog audio converter, otherwise known as DAC. And you know what? Why include only one when you can actually include two? Now, one thing that the microcontroller I chose for this project was lacking was the ability to talk directly to audio DACs using an audio protocol that is called the I2S. Unfortunately, that microcontroller doesn't have such devices. Obviously, for future revisions, I will choose such a microcontroller. But for this board, the only thing that I had were the regular SPI interfaces. So this is why I needed to add those third and fourth CPLD devices here. So I use them to synchronize the audio data that is coming from the microcontroller, which runs on its internal clock, to the actual sample rate of the audio DACs that is derived from this oscillator here. Obviously, once the conductor was able to play audio soundtracks, it needed to send animation data to the actual animatronic. So this is why the board includes a connector to what I call AnimaMaestro controllers. If you want to learn more about the other electronic PCBs that I designed for this project, you can take a look at my AnimaMaestro controllers and AnimaMaestro units video series. The last two devices that are included with the AnimaMaestro Conductor are really just extra gadgets. You know, I included them because I wanted to learn how to use them, but mainly because they were fun. So the first one is called a real-time clock, or RTC. So it is a device that is able to keep track of time and date. And the one that I chose for this project also includes an internal battery, so it is able to keep track of time even when the power is off. Also, because the RTC device includes a non-volatile memory, I use it to store persistent configuration data for this device. But really, the most interesting feature that comes with the RTC is that it has an alarm that you can set, and it will generate a signal called an interrupt signal when the alarm goes off. So I use this signal in conjunction with my power controller CPLD to automatically turn on the device and start playing back a predetermined animation when the alarm goes off. So don't you agree that it's a really nice feature to have? So finally, the last module that I included in the project is an RF module, or radio frequency module, that allows me to communicate with the conductor using radio signal. So talking about another nice gadget to have. So when used in conjunction with a second RF module, I could design this remote control here to be able to operate the device remotely. So if you want to learn more about the design and implementation of the remote control, you can take a look at my AnimaMaestro Remote video series. So this is what my AnimaMaestro Conductor board can do so far. So the shape of the board was actually determined by the casing that I found, which I thought was the perfect size for this project. I basically cut holes and mounted the various components using small M2 screws. So, in the upcoming videos of this series, we're going to take a deeper look at the design of the circuit. We're going to look at the choice of the electronic components. We're going to actually design the PCB and have it made and start assembling the components on it. So, meanwhile, I want to thank you for watching. I want to remind you that if you're new to the channel, please consider subscribing and turn on the notification bell. If you enjoyed this video, please hit the like button and leave me a comment below. That would really help the channel to grow. You can also watch these two videos, and until next time, keep creating.